A lot of things can be beautiful. Landscapes, faces, fine art, or epic architecture, stars in the sky, or simply the reflection of the sun on an empty bottle. Beauty is nothing tangible, it only exists in our heads as a pleasant feeling. If we have to define it, we perceive something as beautiful if its color, shape, form, or proportion somehow are appealing or delightful to us. Beauty is a very human experience that's been with us for millions of years. Even our first tools were trimmed to a symmetrical shape. Researchers have tried to find...
So we're going to talk about this video because beauty is a big thing in physics, right? You might have seen, you might have heard of a woman on YouTube called Sabine Hossenfelder. She wrote a book recently, a physicist, claiming that beauty has led physics astray. What is she talking about, right? So if you go back, I mean, all times, people doing physics, but particularly, you know, the early 20th century, people were obsessed with this notion of physics, beauty in physics and math, right? They thought beauty was sort of a vision of something deeper. They thought it was, you know, if something wasn't beautiful, it just simply couldn't be true. And that God would only make beautiful equations, right? That would be simple and beautiful. And so you can see how subjective this is. That'd be symmetrical and the symmetry's everywhere. And so that's what I'm getting. That's what we're going to be talking about in this video and sort of rebuttal to Sabine's. Because I don't think beauty does lead physics astray. I think there is something deeper there, potentially. I don't know, but I think probably likely is, you know, something to do with beautiful stuff in physics, nature. There seems to be something going on, okay? Like, just why does math even work? We don't know. So is math invented or discovered? We don't know this stuff, but, you know, now if we just focus in on, like, the beautiful equations we find all over the place in math or physics, you know, why are they so beautiful? Well, we'll talk about it in a minute.
Practical reasons why our ancestors invested the time to make their tools look nice but couldn't really identify any. It seems that early humans shaped their tools into teardrops simply because they liked them better that way. Throughout our
teardrops, I mean, I imagine because it's got a pointy thing to smash stuff with. And maybe it's more sturdy like this. Maybe if you made it thinner, it would break when you smash it against other rocks. I don't like that conclusion.
History, the definition of beauty has changed a lot. Ideals have shifted or turned into their opposites. But beyond individual and contemporary taste, some things have never...
So obviously there's lots of subjective stuff going on when we talk about beauty. But is there some objective... thing that we could like something tangible? Well, I want to think about that. And like just to weigh in here quickly with the subjective stuff. Obviously, you know, as we evolved, humans and all animals, you know, this concept of beauty, you could see where it's emerged from. And it's kind of hard to decipher if it emerged from reproductional things, probably, right? Because our species, at least, right, it's all about reproduction, and a lot of the things we have evolved allow us to either have a higher chance of survival or you know, increase our rate of reproduction, the efficiency, all that sort of stuff, right? So beauty, in a sense, you know, in humans is clearly, like, you know, we find you know, attraction is very important to humans when we look for a mate. Everyone knows this. It's not everything, especially if you're a sapiosexual, right? But we have clearly evolved to find certain characteristics beautiful, which are, you know, clearly will help our young better survive and things like this. And that's why we find certain things beautiful, because our brain has evolved to go, okay, this trait, right, that says high testosterone, or this trait, you know, that means this guy can protect me, or... and basic things like that. And if you don't think that's true, then you're going against evolution and just science in general, really. You know, your brain is obviously simplifying reality a great deal to allow you to kind of just process things efficiently. And it seems like the brain, or we have evolved to see reality in a way that allows us to sort of go about it in the best way for survival, rather than, you know, we're not actually seeing objective reality. it's like a lie. The brain is hallucinating this thing that is not quite really there to help you survive. And so that's, you know, so you can't trust your senses to it, pretty much, when you're trying to decipher what truth is or what reality is. But what you can trust is evidence. And that's why science is so important. It's like another sense that allows us to see true nature, objective nature.
Really gone out of fashion. The golden
what's up,
ratio,
man?
Symmetry or fractal patterns can be found in the art and architecture of cultures from our beginnings to today. Humans seem to be in mysterious inherent agreement about the beauty of certain things. The patterns that keep coming up are all rooted in nature. They became part of our biology because they helped our ancestors survive. Fractal patterns, for example, occur all over nature, in snail shells, flower heads, waves, or clouds. Identifying and assessing these things and phenomena correctly used to be vital. Do those clouds mean rain will come soon? Are these waters safe to swim through? Can I eat this? Another pervasive thing is symmetry. In nature, it means everything.
I'm loving this. This so I just want to stop and think about all these points he's making.
Thing is as it should be. Stems and trees and leaves and blossoms all grow symmetrically. A deer with impressive antlers is probably a source of nutritious meat. A deformed wheat ear may not be safe to eat.
All right, this some of these are a bit of a reach, because, you know, talking about
deformed wheat ear,
this, you know, these beautiful antlers, right? The way we perceive them probably just doesn't change how that they came to be. You know what I mean? I get that he's saying, like, why beautiful things make us happy. But when I see a big fucking thing with big antlers, I don't know if it makes me happy. I think I would think, oh, geez, that's impressive, right? I'm impressed. I don't know if I'm happy. And what I was getting at a minute, like 20 seconds ago, is like, you know, these clearly formed for to help it survive, specific to this organism or its little ecosystem and how it's all interconnected, right? But for us and how we perceive it, I don't think it has any bearing on how it turns out. So I think that was a silly notion, silly thing to say. You should come check out KelVPN, post-quantum VPN I've created. You can get a free little trial. Come check it out. It's got the best encryption on the internet. It can literally protect you from quantum computers.
A source of nutritious meat.
What's wrong with speculating? I love speculating. That's how you figure new things out, right? You'll never figure anything new out in your life if you're not willing to speculate.
A deformed wheat ear may not be safe to eat. Asymmetric.
Antlers for deers. Yeah, for deers. I just didn't go on about the what they do for deers, because he was specifically talking about how to us antlers make us, how they make us feel, and that's why they exist. And it's like, what?
Symmetrical face is more likely to belong to a healthy and fertile mating partner. Because symmetry is so common in fauna and flora, it's extremely familiar to our brain. It helped our ancestors evaluate their environment more easily and react quickly to danger. Things that help us survive activate the reward center in our brain. Recognizing signals of safety and nutrition trigger nice feelings in us. So our sense of beauty probably of...
And if I'm going to say something controversial here, be careful of what you hear neuroscientists claiming on YouTube, please. Right? I'm not going to say anything actually that controversial here, but just be very careful, because there's very little we know. And, you know, they're just ignoring a massive problem with we don't know what consciousness is and how this stuff results in experience. They just ignore it, okay? And they see these things and they think that we then understand how these things manifest. And clearly we don't. So be very, very skeptical and take it with a grain of salt. And I keep seeing people on YouTube claiming these things after, like, there being one study with 20 fucking rats. And they go, this means that. So you should do no fat because these rats, like, that's not very good science, guys.
Trigger nice feelings in us. So our sense of beauty probably evolved from pattern recognition. But it goes way beyond that now.
Our sense of beauty from pattern recognition. Pattern recognition must have been a very deep thing that evolved of, like, you know, very, you know, long ago ancestors, and it would have gotten better clearly over time. Wow, this stuff is so complex to think about. Obviously, it would help if I had some knowledge about some of the structures in the brain as well, but what else is there?
Humans seem to have evolved an instinct for beauty that is deeply hardwired into us. It remains even after other processes in our brain stop working. Alzheimer's patients were asked to rank the beauty of several paintings. Then the experiment was repeated 2 weeks later. The patients had long since forgotten the paintings, but still ranked the beauty of the paintings in the same order. One could argue that this doesn't say much, so what if people stick to their personal preferences? But other research has shown that we have a sort of lowest common denominator when it comes to beauty. In different experiments, people were asked to distinguish real from fake abstract paintings. Some were originals by Mondrian and Pollock that were painted based on strict rules like fractal patterns, while the imitations were not. The majority picked out the original artworks. This worked with paintings from both artists, even though their style...
This is kind of ridiculous. I'm not going to lie, this is so fucking stupid. Sure, if something follows a particular pattern to the dot, it's very easy. Our pattern recognition can identify it. But we're just if he's going to now leap to, you know, we can just identify things that are more objectively beautiful, well, of course we can. But to what degree? Like, to an evolved human sense, not like art. We didn't evolve to look at art. This is clearly preying on our pattern recognition abilities, which are ancient. So this sort of research, which is subjective, to go, you know, out of 10, how beautiful do you think this is? Humans are sort of biased towards often many different types of things. You know, whether it's complexity or something they relate to, these things all come into it. But obviously, there's probably some kind of objective thing in a human brain, which is just typically more beautiful because we humanize everything.
Ours are very different. Another experiment also used abstract artworks, but asked people to pick them out among similar paintings made either by children or animals. Again, the test subjects pointed out the legit paintings whose patterns were carefully planned and not random. So while we have a hard time pinning down what beauty is or what it's based on, we somehow recognize it when we see it. Humans don't navigate nature trying to survive day by day anymore. We left the natural world behind and created our own. We made the objects that surround us, the things we wear and use and look at. As we spread over the planet and our numbers grew, we shaped a completely man-made environment. In the process of doing so, we often neglected beauty in favor of functionality, cost, or efficiency. We built rows and rows of concrete housing blocks that nobody wants to live in. We have ugly underground subway stations, shabby public service buildings, and sprawling malls. One bland, standardized box beside the next. Humans don't like monotony. Eye-tracking software has shown that people keep focusing on details and ornaments of architecture while brushing quickly over blank walls. And not only are they no fun to look at, they actually make us miserable. Experiments with skin sensors showed that looking at vast, dull facades makes us feel bored and uncomfortable. This kind of boredom has been linked to raised heart rates and stress levels. And the opposite seems to be true too.
Correlation does not equal causation.
Over the last decades, more and more studies have found that surroundings that are actually aesthetically pleasing to us can improve our well-being, our behavior, cognitive function, and mood. Our bodies and brains react measurably and visibly to everything that surrounds us. Beauty, in particular, has such a strong impact on our well-being that making useful things beautiful can actually make them better. In 2017, a hospital examined recovery factors through observation and interviews with patients and found that visual art in their lounge areas made them more comfortable and happier about their stay in general. Another study looked at how well patients recovered in a hospital that had two wards. A very old and rather ugly one, and a newly renovated ward. To the researchers' surprise, the patients that stayed in the new renovated environment needed less pain medication and were released on average 2 days earlier than patients recovering in the old ward.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if things like this are true either, simply because, you know, I think the way you look at things, we know the placebo is a thing. And because of that, you know, who knows what the brain is capable of doing when it feels good and is happy and it looks at things in a good way. And I think if you're in a shitty environment, like you just have a higher level of stress generally because you're more worried about things. It's like a cascade of interconnected things. I just imagine people being more stressed in, you know, certain dodgy settings. That would probably correlate with heaps of stuff in terms of recovery.
More beautiful surroundings made them feel better physically. Beauty also has an effect on us on a daily basis. It can improve our general happiness. A study that looked at the main factors influencing the happiness of adults revealed an unexpected result. Besides things like good health and a harmonious family life, individual happiness is affected by how beautiful you find the city you live in. Beauty.
Jesus Christ. Ah, man. It's yeah. Well, I guess, you know, if you want to take something from this video, choose carefully where you decide to live, hey. Might just determine your level of happiness, especially if you don't have much control over your mind, which I would say a lot, that's pretty much everyone, right? A lot of people are pretty bad at controlling their emotions. Maybe we can't.
He scored even higher than cleanliness or safety. So, what can we learn from all of this? We know that we humans have been fine-tuned for millions of years to process visual input and assess our surroundings. It's just what we're programmed to do, and we're starting to learn more about how much beauty as a property is really influencing us.
So, but my whole interest in this video is, like, this is all very interesting as well, and I am very interested in how the human brain perceives reality and what's going on there, but also, at a more deeper level, what is beauty? Like, is there something inhuman about beauty? You know, is consciousness something special? Then I'm trying to get at, like, is there such an objective thing as beauty in nature? Like, because obviously, all this stuff we're talking about is just subjectively beautiful to humans. But is there an objective thing going on? You know, is symmetry objectively beautiful to the universe, to nature? Like, we don't know these questions. It's beautiful to think about through my subjective experience. Do you see what I'm saying? Like, there's clearly an objective reality. Well, I mean, not clearly, right? We all have to sort of just take that as an assumption, because that's why we do science. You've got people doing science all around the world, and we can all go, okay, let's all just agree there seems to be an objective reality, right? So let's just found science on that axiomatic assumption. And then from there, let's decipher as much as we can. But I want to know, is, like, the actual, if there is a true objective reality, is beauty sort of an objective thing? I really think it might be, because, like, math equations seem to describe reality, and why do some certain equations, like all this symmetry stuff, like, what is it fundamentally? Like, what is going on? Do you see what I'm saying? Like, ooh, it's I think it really is touching on something so much deeper than whatever we potentially are. And it could even be touching on, like, maybe not the deepest levels of whatever's going on, but, like, something just transcendent to us. Like, I think that's what's going on. And that's why physicists for a long time have been obsessed with finding beauty in physics. They think it leads them to a higher truth. They think beauty in the equations that we try to decipher is somehow transcendent to whatever we are and whatever we can think about and understand. And you might just jump to a conclusion like, oh, that sounds like horseshit. But it has helped physicists a lot of times in the past. For instance, Dirac basically predicted antimatter, you know, through theoretical means, just by sort of using beauty as a guiding sort of principle. You know, the antimatter side of the equation, when he was combining some of Einstein's stuff with some quantum stuff, he realized, hang on, like, you know, this isn't, you got to add a symmetry sort of here. And that resulted in him being like, oh, and he didn't believe it for a bit. And then we shortly after actually experimentally verified this antimatter stuff is real. And so you can see, like, beauty seems to, at least a human's objective subjective version of it when we look out at nature. Okay, so I think that video is done. There was a couple